So I'm going to talk to you about our program called the Comprehensive Care Physician Program, which is really about redesigning care for patients at increased risk of hospitalization. So I think we've all heard endlessly about the inexorable rise of healthcare costs, and it's very easy as you look at that data to imagine it will continue forever. But the reality is we have examples, even recent examples, of how changes in public policy have really reduced healthcare costs. The figure on your right is the reduction in annual growth in hospital expenditures when Medicare established the prospective payment system in the mid-1980s. And hospital cost growth went from 14 to 15% per year down to 3 or 4 in a matter of years. And so public policies can make a difference. But if there's one lesson that health economics has taught us that's most important about healthcare costs in the past half century, it is that the vast majority of money is spent by an incredibly small fraction of people. The picture on the right there is Willie Sutton, the bank robber, who when caught and asked, "Why do you rob banks?" said, "Well, that's where the money is." And so if you really want to reduce healthcare costs, these are the people you have to worry about, the 25% of people who are responsible for 85% of the money. And where are those people and where is that money spent? It's in hospitals like ours. And so if we are going to address high costs, we need to address the costs of people who are in those hospitals. So I am the chief of the section of hospital medicine, and I have lived the growth of that field. It is a change from how healthcare used to be. Traditionally in the US, we had primary care doctors who cared for patients both in clinic and in the hospital. They would spend their morning in the hospital rounding on their own patients, in the afternoon they would see patients in clinic. Then in the mid-1990s, the term hospitalist was invented, these doctors who spend at least a quarter of their time in inpatient care, and the movement just exploded. There are over 30,000 hospitalists in the US today. They're caring for one-third of all general medicine admissions. Incredible belief that this is going to improve costs, outcomes, but I've been wondering and asking, is this change in specialization really a desirable one? And can we improve care by understanding even why hospitalists arose? So as I've looked at this, from the lens of an economist interested in the advantages and disadvantages of hospitalists. On the advantage side, you have inpatient focus, presence, expertise, they're specialists. On the other hand, you have the disadvantages of specialization, in particular the loss of the doctor-patient relationship, being cared for by someone you've never met, the coordination costs between inpatient and outpatient doctors. And theory, whether economic theory, such as that by Adam Smith, or medical theories, the classic work by Francis Peabody on the doctor-patient relationship, or even popular theories like Marcus Welby, emphasize on the one hand that there are these benefits of specialization, but also real costs and harms, and that the right way to think about specialization is as balancing these things. There's another perspective which I want to bring today, which is what's called an adaptive organization perspective. It's a much newer idea in economic theory, and it argues when you're stuck between a rock and a hard place where you want to be really specialized because there's lots to know, and you don't want to be too specialized because you got to make all the pieces fit together, sound a lot like healthcare, you got to figure out a different way to do it. And the way to do it is to focus, to try not to care for every type of patient but a certain type. This is what Clay Christensen at Harvard Business School has called the solution. Shop. And the solution I'm going to describe to you is one for these frequently hospitalized patients. Now, as I've been looking at this problem, I focused a lot of my work on the sort of balancing of two theories about the growth of hospitalists. On the one hand, there was the belief that hospitalists grew to meet the needs of hospital care, the belief that they would lower hospital costs, they'd improve outcomes. But on the opposite side, there's this recognition that they lack the knowledge, the trust, the communication with patients, and the interpersonal relationships that comes from durable doctor-patient relationships. And these things you can talk about theoretically, but you can also translate them into concrete measurable outcomes. My favorite study in this area is a randomized control trial done in the VA about 20 years ago, where they literally randomized complex patients either to get the same primary care doctor in every visit or a completely different primary care doctor in every visit. What happened when they got a different, let's put it this way. What happened when they got the same doctor in every primary care visit? Hospitalizations went down 50 to 75%. So if you don't believe continuity is important, that's a very hard thing to explain. So I don't believe, and in fact, the evidence doesn't really support that hospitalists grew because they're better. In fact, I think hospitalists grew to meet the needs of ambulatory care because it was easier for doctors. The problem was primary care doctors no longer had enough patients in the hospital on a daily basis to justify making the trip in every morning. Why? Not because fewer patients were in the hospital, but because people were filling ambulatory visits with low acuity issues. So it just wasn't worth the trip. And we've actually modeled this formally using economic theory and tested it and confirmed with data that the growth of hospitalists was explained not by being better for patients, but by being easier for doctors. And we confirmed that by showing that when doctors had falling admission rates, they abandoned the hospital. When communication costs declined, so it was easier to call, doctors just called. When transport costs rose, so doctors couldn't get through the hospital lot, they just left the patients to the hospitalists. And as physicians wanted to work fewer hours, they just stopped going to the hospital. And all those pictures are pictures from the famous TV series Marcus Welby, showing exactly these trends playing out in that series. So if hospitalists, it just leaves you wondering, are hospitalists really better for patients? I think no. But maybe more importantly, how could we address care coordination? So when we look at care coordination, there's been a lot done to try to improve it. And the Congressional Budget Office summarized the lessons from 30 Medicare care coordination projects several years ago. And what they showed, sadly, is on average, these programs didn't make a difference. They sometimes reduced admissions, they never really saved money. And you could stratify them by how much interaction there was between the patient and the doctor, between the patient and the care coordinator and the doctor. And what you discover is almost all these programs are about hiring a care coordinator who works between these people. And the more separation there is between those, the less well they work. And there are a number of other lessons about targeting high-risk enrollees, using data, focusing on care transitions, using team-based care, and maybe most importantly, limiting the cost of the intervention. Because the fundamental problem is if you spend a lot of money to hire a care coordinator, coordinate care, you still got to coordinate that person with everyone and you can't make the money back. So we'd love to find a way to coordinate care without those costs. So this is where the idea comes in. We'd love to have primary care doctors see their own patients in the hospital, but they just can't do it because they don't have enough. So the idea is we prospectively identify those patients at high risk of hospitalization, and we have these doctors set up a practice that only includes patients at high risk of hospitalization. So instead of caring for 2,000 or 3,000 patients in the year, they just care for 200. And with that small panel, they can give these doctors all the ambulatory care they need, spending their afternoons at clinic, and yet every morning be in the hospital to give those patients the care that they need. What are the advantages? The most frequently hospitalized patients get their own doctor in both settings. Patients value the continuity and the relationship. You decrease unneeded testing and treatment. It's an easier job for the doctor because they already know the patient. All hospitalized patients get doctors who are experts, like hospitalists, and are physically in the hospital on a regular basis. Patients can choose their own doctor. They can't with hospitalists. This can be practical for the doctor with a small panel size. You can use this in a patient-centered medical home or with bundling with readmission penalties to save money for the hospital. And if you have a small, struggling hospital that needs a primary care base to fill beds, you can hire a few doctors and save the hospital. The challenge is, will enough patients be willing to switch? Will doctors let these patients switch? Will doctors even do this job? Can it be economically viable? To answer this, we got money from the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation through the Affordable Care Act to actually build this model out in 2012, and we started a randomized trial. These are the key elements of the program. We focus on high-cost patients expected to spend at least 10 days a year in the hospital, spending typically $50,000 or more dollars per year. We maximize the direct interaction with the doctor by limiting the panel size to only 200 patients. They spend their morning in the hospital, their afternoon in clinic. We build a small and very tight interdisciplinary team that's multidisciplinary, but where everyone works together very closely, organized around the patient's needs. We keep the cost low with this small, well-connected team. We focus on care transitions. We've prepared for new financial incentives. We try to sustain and support the members of the care team. These are incredibly sick patients. We use rapid cycle innovation techniques using data week to week to improve the model. And we did rigorous evaluation, a randomized controlled trial, Medicare claims data, an external evaluator, surveys every 3 months. So where are we? Well, we've successfully built and refined the program operations. We've learned a ton about how to make this work. I'm proud to say we've now recruited 1,950 of 2,000 patients. And within a few weeks, we'll have our enrollment done. We'll have final results in 18 months. I'm not allowed to tell you the results, which is incredibly frustrating. But what I can tell you is we've gotten really positive interim, both qualitative and quantitative impressions. We measure quality of care, health outcomes, cost outcomes. We use data on individual patients to help these doctors improve care. We have weekly discussions of complex or informative cases to inform the model. And I can assure you that I could pay for the entire cost of this program with savings that could come from just one or two of our patients, given how extraordinary their expenditures are. We're now addressing longer term issues, financial models for expansion and sustainability, whether under fee for service or new risk-based contracting models, and we're actually translating these things into practice with applications at the University of Chicago, and increasingly disseminating this to local, national, and international hospitals and even communities. And one of the things we're beginning to look at is networks of comprehensive care physicians who connect hospitals in diverse areas, creating clinical integration, but also supporting competition, which we know increases quality. And then finally, we're working now to reach the very most difficult to reach patients. It's about 30% of patients who we care for who are randomized to our intervention but never engage in it. And we've just gotten funding from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation for what we're calling the Comprehensive Care Community and Culture Program, where in addition to these doctors, we're going to have community health workers who work directly under their supervision and also actually engage the program, the patients in arts program to empower them and get them to be more engaged with our program. So let me stop there and thank you.